Yeah, now we are finally getting to the more interesting part of this lecture, talking about dropout. Or at least that's what I find a little bit more interesting, because it's a method specifically developed for neural networks and not just an extension of generalized linear models. So to keep things a little bit organized, I split this topic into four sub-topics. However, don't worry, these will be probably very short videos, so there are not many slides per topic, but I thought it's just simpler to organize it this way. So in this first video, I want to just give you the brief big picture overview, the main concept behind dropout, and then we will talk about the co-adaptation technique, interpretation of dropout, and then we will talk about the ensemble method interpretation, and then we will see how we can do that in PyTorch. So for reference, if you're interested, you can later also check out these papers. They are pretty nicely written and not too complicated. So these two papers, as far as I know, are the original papers proposing dropout. So one goes back to 2012. It's entitled Improving Neural Networks by Preventing Co-Adaptation of Feature Detectors. So like I mentioned, we will see what this co-adaptation interpretation means later. And there's also another interpretation, it goes back to this second paper, Dropout, A Simple Way to Prevent Neural Networks from Overfitting. This is like the more like the ensemble interpretation. But yeah, we will talk about this in more detail. I just wanted to give you these references for these methods. So if you want to check out more details, you can find them here. So what is the main concept behind Dropout? So in a nutshell, it's about dropping nodes. So suppose you have a multi-layer perceptron. Here that's a very small one. Essentially, it's during training, randomly dropping nodes. So for example, here as shown, you would randomly drop this node with a certain probability. So if you say the dropout probability is 0.5, like 50%, then during training, for each node, you would say with 50% probability, I will just delete it during the forward pass. And in each training forward pass, it will be different nodes that will be deleted because it's a probability. So you randomly create different models. So one forward pass might delete this one. Another forward pass would have these two deleted. Another forward pass may have this one deleted and so forth. So why that is useful? There are a couple of theories and we will talk about this. Here's just like the big picture overview. How it works. I mean, like what's happening basically. And then why that helps, that is a topic for the next video. Yeah, now the question is, how can we implement that efficiently? So how can we implement a dropout without having to make any major modifications to our neural network architecture, like deleting nodes or something like that? So how can we just do it conveniently? So one way would be by implementing a Bernoulli sampling procedure. So for that, we can define a drop probability P. So for example, this could be 50% or let's say 0.5. That's our drop probability. So with that probability for each given node, it's the probability that we drop that node. Now we create a vector here. So it's like a random vector, a random sample from a uniform distribution in the range 0 and 1. So this vector will have the same number of elements as the size of the hidden layer that we want to apply dropout to. So dropout is only applied to hidden layers. It's not applied to the output layer. So now let's say we have done that. We have, let's say, 5 units in our hidden layer. So we have 5 numbers between 0 and 1. I'm just writing down some arbitrary numbers here. Oops. Like this. And now that is when we apply basically a Bernoulli sampling, where we say for each value in that vector, for each value vi, we set this value to 0 if this value is smaller than the drop probability, otherwise we set it to 1. So we are modifying this now that it is a binary vector. So this one is smaller than 0.5, so we set it to 1. This one, oh sorry, it should be 0. This one is greater, so we set it to 1. This one is smaller, so we set it to 0. This one, it's on the border. We have defined smaller, so let's set it to 1. And then this one would be also a 0. So we have now this binary vector. And then we can simply multiply this binary vector with our activations A. So these are the activations in our hidden layer. And then now we have effectively canceled activations. And yeah, that's it. That's how we can apply dropout during training. Okay, so but there's one little thing we have to adjust if we want to use our model for inference, like making predictions on new data or even computing the test set accuracy. So yeah, the reason is we don't want to have any randomness when we make real world predictions, right? So it would be a little bit awkward if, let's say we predict some, let's say credit scores, but sometimes random nodes get dropped, so the customer would on different days get different credit scores, although nothing else has changed. So that way we don't want to have any randomness during testing. So the dropout is only applied during training. So what that means, we don't do any removal of the nodes during testing. However, there's one additional thing we have to do when we want to remove the dropping of the nodes. And that has to do with the scale of the activations. So assume I have a multi-layer perceptron with multiple hidden layers. Let's call that hidden layer H1 and this hidden layer H2. And they are fully connected to each other, like always. So now if I drop one of the nodes though in H1 via dropout, let's say I do it like this, or let's say it like this. Each value here is the same. The weights are all 1 and the activations are all 1, just to keep things simple. So if this is the case, the activation at that given node here is 1 times 1 plus 1 times 1 plus 1 times 1. It's 3, right? So if I have the sum over the weights and activations from the previous layer, if I sum that up, the net input, let's say the net input is 3, because all the weights and all the activations are 1, just for simplicity. Now, if I drop one of these nodes during using dropout, then now I only have 2 inputs, so the value now is only 2 instead of 3, because I only have 2 incoming activations when computing the net input. Okay, so that means, this doesn't have any, or is not a problem during training, of course. I mean, this is just like some arbitrary numbers I'm showing you here. But now, if you don't do any dropout during testing, all the activations will be larger, right? So during testing, we don't have any dropout. So the values are actually larger than during training. During training, we had a value of, let's say, 2. And during testing, we will have a value of 3. However, everything in the network is kind of has learned to work with these smaller values. So the threshold, let's say in the last layer for the prediction, would not really work for these larger values now, because we have all now throughout the whole network larger values because we don't drop any nodes, and that could be awkward. So what we do is we just scale these activations. That's like a very simple trick to deal with this problem. So let's say we have a drop probability of 0.5 and we have an activation of 3. Well, let's say 2 during training, because this one node got randomly dropped. I mean, this is just a simplification. And then during testing, the value here that comes in here is 3, because there is no dropping of any node. So we have now this problem that this is too large. So how can we do it, get it smaller? Here we can just scale it by 1 minus the drop probability. So in this case, okay, this doesn't make quite sense because this is not an even number. Let's do it properly here. Okay, sorry. So let's do a network where we have 1, 2, 3, 4. And 1, 2, 3 nodes here. Same thing applies during training. We drop 50%, so we drop 2 nodes randomly. So the value during training we get is 2. But during testing, we don't drop anything, so the value we may get at this node here is now 4. So how do we scale it? We can scale it by 1 minus the drop probability. For example, can have then 4 times 1 minus 0.5, which is 4 times 0.5, which is essentially 2. So in this way, we scale all the predictions during training, testing. So that's like a simple trick to deal with these activations that might be too large during testing. And yeah, this is essentially how Dropout works. So in the next video, I want to talk about the co-adaptation interpretation. So one way to interpret Dropout, why it might work in practice. Then there's an alternative interpretation from looking at Dropout as an ensemble method. And then I will show you how we can do Dropout in PyTorch. And there's also a concept for that called inverted Dropout, which will be interesting. It's a slight modification of what I just talked about. It's called inverted Dropout. I will talk about that when we talk about the implementation.